Hello, I'm Paul Briley, and you're listening to Off the Comma. I'm a human who cares about supporting other humans. On this podcast, we explore all facets of what it means to feel stuck in life. We talk with people just like us who found themselves sitting on a comma and not knowing where to go next. We'll unpack the experience with them, where they've been stuck, what it feels like, what they experienced, and what they learned. My goal is to inspire you by seeing yourself in others. I believe that when we feel more connected and seen, magic can happen. And remember, if you find yourself sitting on a comma in your life, you can also talk to me without a microphone. To explore coaching with me and getting off the comma in your own life, check out my information and book a call with me at offthecomma.com. And I'm also doing something different. I'm curating my own sponsor community, local businesses and professionals who I handpick and who align with our vision here. Be sure to check them out, learn more about them on my website and my YouTube channel. In the meantime, let's get into this week's conversation. And we are back with another episode of Off the Comma. We are just really on a roll. We are talking to so many people with so many really inspiring stories and so many things that folks are sharing with us about their own experiences with being stuck and getting unstuck. And I have certainly enjoyed this kind of last wave of new guests that we've been talking to. And today's not going to be any exception to that as well. I'm really excited today for a couple of reasons, because as has been the case and will continue to be the case for the foreseeable future, I have the privilege of talking to people that I don't already know, who aren't already in my circle. So I'm getting to meet all these new people, these cool people, learn about them through their stories. I am really excited because today I'll be talking to Kate Galli, and not only is she another new person that I'm getting to meet, but also she's the first person that we've talked to on this podcast from Australia. So she's going to tell us a little bit about that when we introduce her. But one of my goals for the podcast is not only are we talking to everyday people everywhere, but all over the world. And we've had some international guests so far, and that's continuing to grow. And now we're all the way, reaching our arms all the way around to the other side of the planet. To you, Kate, I'm going to shut up. I'm going to turn it over to you. Kate, tell us a little bit about yourself. Tell us, how would you like to be known? And what would be important for us to know about you before we get into your story?
Thank you so much, Paul. It is a pleasure to be here with you. I would love to be known as passionate, focused, and a person who leads with love and compassion and animal-free deliciousness. So that was a hard lesson for me to learn. I often talk about how I went from being an angry vegan to leading with love, and how love is so much easier than hate. What else is important to know about me? I'm a health coach. I'm an author. I'm a fellow podcaster. And the health side of things, do you know, I got into that almost 3 decades ago as a way to transform both my body and also my confidence. And that is one of the things that I still love today, so far as working with other people and helping them change their body and change their life.
Nice. Well, and I'm sure this is all going to show up in the story that you're going to be sharing with us. So I'm very much looking forward to this. And self-referencing just a little bit, I'm not a vegan, but January I'll be going into my 3rd year of basically vegetarianism, and not because of health reasons or anything like that, but really just it was just something that I was ready for. And here in California, we already know kind of the value and the benefits of plant-based lifestyles. And so I'm real curious to hear what your experience has been like and where it's taken you.
I love that. That absolutely warms my heart, because I have been bouncing from one topic to the other so far as, you know, the time in my life that I've been sitting on a comma. And I think you've confirmed for me, Paul, which time I am going to share.
Oh, okay. Nice. Well, I'm honored. Thank you. All right. Well, I tell you what, Kate, before we get into your story and the 5 questions, and I think I've already said to the folks here that I really don't know your story. I'm looking forward to hearing it. The first thing I like to do with every guest on every episode is, as you think ahead to the time that we're going to spend together, the next 40, 45 minutes or so, and the story you're going to share, what would be your intention for yourself today?
To be open-hearted. Mm.
What does that mean for you?
It's something that I am so drawn to in other people. I think it is sadly rare, and absolutely it is a to work on for me that has been a primary focus over the past almost 3 years. And it's about having love and compassion, and it's all about your intention, right? Your intention in the world every single day, and also your intention in every single interaction and communication, whether that be face-to-face with someone in my life today, right now, or whether it be with the potentially thousands of people that could be listening to our conversation today, Paul.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that. My intention is to support you in this intention of being open-hearted and to create the space for you to be able to tell your story. And my hope is that there will be people out there who will hear a little bit of themselves in you and your story, make them feel a little bit more connected, a little less alone, and in the best of cases, a little bit more inspired and even empowered to go out and do something that they've secretly been wanting to do, or maybe not so secretly.
Amazing.
Let's get into your story. So, Kate, the first question is, where in your life have you found yourself sitting on a comma?
So the time I'm going to share is almost 9 years ago now, probably 8.5 years ago, when at that point in time, I had actually been vegetarian for the animals for around 23 mm-hmm. years. I became vegetarian as a 16-year-old when another girl at school explained to me what happened to those individuals that we ate. I became vegetarian overnight. Didn't do it so healthy early days. In fact, I did it really unhealthily. And fast forward, you know, however many years vego, I became a personal trainer. I was doing really well in my craft. I was that fit, strong vegetarian trainer that advocated for a high protein, low carbohydrate vegetarian lifestyle. And then I watched the documentary Cowspiracy, and I learned that if I was vegetarian for the animals, actually I needed to be vegan for the animals. And there was no stuck point, no sitting on a comma with that decision. That was a, I won't say easy decision. There was fear around it because I thought, how might that impact the way that my body looks and functions? And you know, now that sounds really vain, but as a personal trainer, people are looking at you and judging you and potentially the quality of the work that you do by the way that your body looks and moves. So there was fear, especially working in a really gym bro type of a gym. The stuck on the comma came the year or so after that, when yes, I was a vegan, yes, the food was the easy part. You know, I made it a little bit hard for myself early days. However, I learned pretty quickly how to make delicious meals, and the impact on my body and health were only positive. What became really difficult is I got really involved in the animal rights activist scene in Sydney, where I lived at that point in time. And I met so many beautiful, amazing people whose values and beliefs and passion were completely aligned with mine. And it was amazing. I needed that community. It was really, really important. The issue became that it started to mean that I focused on everything that I didn't have in common with the non-vegans in my life. So it really started to affect my relationships with the people I love most, with my family, with my old friends, with my colleagues in the gym, with all of my clients who had been with me over a decade, many of them at that point in time. And so the stuck point, the painful point for me, you know, I became a really angry vegan, and it cost me a lot so far as the relationships in my life. And I'll say the joy and happiness in my life when you're always focusing on what's sad and frustrating and what's making you angry. It's not a good place.
I so appreciate you sharing this, because this really opens up, and I know you're going to share so much more, but it opens up this whole conversation around, we hear it a lot, especially I hear it in California. Maybe it's because I'm a vegan or vegetarian, right? Like I pay attention to this kind of content, but you know, people who are meat eaters and non-vegetarian, non-vegan or whatever, kind of think, some of them think and feel a certain way about vegans and vegetarians, you know, I'm looking for a word there, subsequently tend to feel the same way about meat eaters or feel a certain way about meat eaters. And so there's this whole kind of like us versus them in the diet and food space. And yet it's also representative of so many other types of spaces. And I know that's not going to be your focus today, but I think, you know, for folks out there to think about, you know, oh, okay, well that's those, you know, meat and non-meat folks and that's their problem. But it can be the same conversations, right? When it comes to like, I'm also somebody who no longer drinks alcohol and there's the drinkers versus the non-drinkers. And then there's so many other places that this same dynamic can show up. But let's bring it back to you because I want to hear more about the experience with you. So you basically had chosen a lifestyle and that centered around your food and your diet and your nutrition, had been in that lifestyle for a long period of time. It sounds like it evolved and then became more committed, more intense. And then you started to see another kind of stage of evolution where it now started to go in a non kind of resourceful sort of way for you.
Yeah, I just want to skip back and really agree with you on that point. There are so many subjects that are polarizing and that cause conflict mm-hmm. in our life and in our relationships. And, you know, for the listeners who are like, oh, that's just the crazy vegan animal rights activist, it absolutely relates to religion and politics and anything that you are super passionate about that is really important to you and other people you love aren't on the same page. Mm. So to skip forward back to your actual question, yeah, I made this huge lifestyle change and actually it wasn't about food at all. It was absolutely about compassion. Mm. Yes, food was one of the changes I had to make. However, and you don't know that until you're here, but before you make the change, you think food is going to be the real struggle street, right? That's going to be what's really challenging, you know, and especially as someone whose career was health and fitness and all about the way my body looks and functions. I thought that would be the big bit. However, as I've shared, actually relationships were the big bit. And my slow, hard learned lesson is as much respect as I have for all those animal rights activists out there, so much respect. I hold you in my heart. I love you all. For me personally, I came to learn that the kind of hardline approach was not effective in my relationships. Mm-hmm. And the challenge was that if I had met some, again, I'm saying this with love, if I had met some crazy vegan animal rights activist as a 16-year-old, I would have been grateful and I would have gone vegan overnight, not vegetarian. So it would have worked for me. However, I'm not the norm. And my lesson is to learn what appeals to the majority of people because that's how I'm going to have the greatest impact. So yeah, I got myself in a really stuck position where I was just focusing on everything that was different and also everything that was bad. You know, if you're, whatever you focus on expands, right? And if you're constantly just aware of all the atrocities humans are inflicting on animals every single day, like that takes a whole lot of energy. And that is energy that you don't have for other positive things and positive relationships in your life. And I'd like to say I walked myself out of this situation. However, what got me out of it was absolutely no doubt the hardest moment of my life ever.
Mm. I want to acknowledge and reflect for a moment, and then I want to explore that a little bit further. Thank you for correcting me too. You're right. It wasn't just about the food. It was about compassion and it was about the way that animals are treated. And I think that's a very important thing for us to clarify and for you to have pointed out for me. And I believe that's also what made me choose to go vegetarian was I could even wrap my head around eating animals. It's the way we process them and that we don't treat them with compassion and respect before we eat them. Right. So that's my story, but I appreciate that distinction. And it's interesting how you say compassion is what led you into this journey. And then this back end part that you've been talking about the way that compassion plays into or doesn't play into, like, compassion for who and at what point in time and under what circumstances, right? So I'll stop there. This really just kind of a reflection. Correct me.
Really good catch, though. Really good catch. Initially, my compassion was all for the animals. And then I realized I needed to have compassion for myself as well, to the point that I got ahimsa, which means compassion for all living beings, including yourself, tattooed on my wrist. Mm. But it took me a really long time to learn that I also needed to extend that compassion to all the other humans in my life, especially the ones that I'm closest to. There's no limit to our compassion. I was just a little slow in learning that one.
Yeah. What was the hardest part when you said kind of towards the point before the shift where your relationships were suffering, you were focusing on the negative? What was the hardest part during that time window?
I think all the censoring of myself and then exploding when you're still surrounding yourself. You know, I was going to animal activism events nearly every weekend where we're showing the horrific footage of animals in slaughterhouses and such. And so I was very upfront and in that world of everything awful that's going on. And then I'd rock into the gym 5 days a week and clients would be telling me about the roast lamb they had. And I'd learnt that you don't just jump in and go, you know, share the story of how that lamb was slaughtered. I'd learned, don't do that. So I'd be censoring myself. So I'd see all the worst of it. And then I'd have to censor myself 24/7, even with many of my dear friends. And then that would build up and I'd just lose it and say something, you know, I'd drop some vegan truth bomb at the wrong point in time and it wouldn't go down well. And, you know, I'd think, well, that wasn't very effective. And now I feel kind of bad. And so does that other person. So there was a lot of conflict and just a lot of energy not being used to a good end.
I can appreciate this that you're describing of the, it's such a challenge, right? To see something that is truth for you and that it is so kind of undeniable, and then to experience folks who haven't seen that truth living in an entirely different truth. And how do you moderate and temper? How do you define what is true? You know, I had a friend who flat out said to me one day, animals are just meant to be eaten, right? So then, you know, with that person, there's no interest in exploring any other point of view. They've established their point of view. But here you are working with multiple people all the time and having to kind of hide your truth until you can't.
Yeah, absolutely. For sure.
Before we get to the second question, one of the things you said a moment ago that was kind of like a punctuation point was, and before things shifted for you, it was the hardest point in your life, or those weren't your exact words, but you were kind of leading us up to a, where was the funnel, the narrowest, tightest, and most uncomfortable?
Yeah, this is huge. And there's a bit of backstory to it. So you need to know a little bit about my family situation, I guess, you know. So we're going back probably about 6 years now. I'd been vegan a few years. And my dear mum, mum and dad lived in a different state to me. They lived in Queensland. I lived in Sydney. I'd always go home at Christmas time. And our families are huge foodies. And my mum shows love with food. And it's really important to all of us. And mum rang me up and she said, Katie, I don't know what to do about Christmas. You're this animal rights activist and your dad's anti-vegan. And I don't know what to do unless you mastermind a vegan feast and sell the family on it. And I was like, amazing. I am down for that feast. Maybe you can sell the family on it. Anyway, I came, I cooked 6 new dishes. They were amazing. It was all really well received. My mum was so grateful because I'd gone to so much work and it was such a success. And it was a beautiful Christmas. And the day before I flew back to Sydney, Mum said, "Katie, will you watch What the Health with me?" And now, bit of backstory, Paul, What the Health was a documentary that I had been emotionally blackmailing my parents to watch from the very moment I turned vegan, because I thought it might sink in and I cared about their health. And funnily enough, emotional blackmail was not impactful. However, after this beautiful family Christmas where I'd gone to so much effort, Mum said, "Can you watch it with me?" She was really struck by the documentary. As a nurse for 30 years, she really connected with both the fact that we have a broken sick care system rather than a more preventative health and lifestyle focused system. She also really empathized with the individuals who were negatively impacted by living near huge factory farms. And she said, "I'm going to try this plant-based thing for 2 weeks." So before I flew home, we went shopping, we went to the farmer's market, we stocked her up with all this plant-based deliciousness. And fast forward, Mum was plant-based, verging on vegan, getting a bit animal rights activist-y, listening to all my podcasts, watching all the documentaries, even the really brutal ones, for years until almost 3 years ago. On a Sunday afternoon, which had been such a beautiful Sunday, I'd spoken to my mum at 7 a.m. in the morning as I went for a walk along the beaches in Sydney. Normal day, awesome conversation. At about 4 p.m. that Sunday, I got the phone call from my father that I always thought I'd get from my mother. I always thought Mum would call me and she'd be, "Katie, it's your dad." Because Dad isn't healthy in mindset or nutrition or anything really. And Mum was the most loving, generous, warm, open-hearted person I have met in my life. And it was a phone call from Dad saying, "Kate, it's your mum." And Mum had died suddenly. Mm. And she was my person. She was Dad's person too. She was my number one person, and she was the only person besides my new vegan friends that actually had the courage to change their lifestyle. And this is something that I couldn't have loved her more. However, our relationship had grown so much over those past few years as she went from trying this plant-based thing to becoming pretty much full vegan. And it was something we really connected over. And anyway, she was, all of a sudden, she was gone just like that after speaking to her at 7 a.m. And the reason that eventually tipped me out of my, you know, sitting on a comma stuck point was because I had been carrying around all this anger and frustration and sadness. And when you hear that the most important person in your life is all of a sudden gone, the overwhelming sadness and grief there, yeah, no more room for any of that other emotion. Doesn't matter how important it was. There was just no more room for any of that.
My condolences on the loss of your mother. And I can hear what an impact that loss had on you in just the little bit that you've shared with us so far. And you're describing everything that you had been carrying being replaced with grief. Let me go ahead and ask the second question, and maybe it'll take you into where I was curious. And you can always go back and forth here as you look back at this point in your life, this comma you were sitting on. What did it create for you? So that's a general question, but I'm also curious about this point where you said the grief for your mother replaced everything else, what that created for you as well. So you can take us where you want to take us with that.
Absolutely. So pre-mum dying, you know, that angry vegan, what it created for me was just sadness and frustration and anger at nearly everyone in the world, because vegans are probably 2% of the population max. So that's what it created. When Mum suddenly died, it created, firstly, as I explained, that, you know, no more energy for all of that emotion I'd been feeling. It was all just grief and shock. And also, it created an awareness that with Mum, I had no regrets. She knew how much I loved and respected her, and vice versa. You know, zero regrets. However, I knew that if that had been my father, I absolutely would have had regrets because our relationship really was not that good. And I mean, we disagree on most of the big things, actually. It's not just animal rights and veganism and the way we both eat and compassion. We really disagree on some huge things. However, I realized, you know, that that wasn't the relationship I wanted to have with him. If I wanted to maintain a relationship with him, I needed to get better at focusing on those things that were there that we did have in common. Especially, I guess, the fact that, you know, we were both going through the biggest loss you can ever imagine.
You're describing this kind of pivot point where now all of the attention is on your dad because you realized that if he had passed, you would have had regrets. And now I'm hearing you describe, like, you've shifted away from my point of view, my beliefs, my truths, and subsequently my anger and resentment to now, oh, what am I going to do to build this relationship? And now you're shifting into the, well, what do we have in common?
Yeah. And it's an ongoing practice as well, because I'll be honest, it's not easy. I went through the phase of comparing him to mom, and to be blunt, he always comes up lacking and he always will. And that's not effective, you know, and even if I choose my words, any of us, we choose our words, right? People can still feel your energy and intention. And I learned that. I'd stop myself from, I'd be counting the number of animals dead on his plate. And even the fact that I'm counting it and not saying it, they can see the judgment. They can feel the judgment, you know? So it took at least a year, I would say, of, you know, the first step in any change is in awareness. I had to have an awareness of what the way that I was interacting in the world, what that was costing me right now in my life, and how life would look in, you know, 6 months, 12 months, 24 months if nothing changed. You know, life would be pretty hugely unfun. And also, you know, I still care just as much about the animals in a vegan world, right? And I want to be effective for the animals. Mm. So I always coach myself. There's my mad, passionate little animal rights activist heart. And then there's what's most effective. And so I do often have to take a pause before I say something or react. So that awareness was really important. And I think that relates to anyone listening, whatever you're struggling with, a conflict in your life and it's not working for you, particularly in your relationships with loved ones. It's important to, if you want to change, have an awareness of how life is going to look for you in the future, you know, if nothing does change. And the second part for me was to brainstorm the things that I could start doing and the things that I could stop doing. So for example, I stopped going to those animal rights activism events, not because I didn't believe in them or I didn't like the people or I couldn't relate to the people, just because they made it too hard for me to come back and have love and compassion for the people that weren't on the same page. I stopped sharing those brutal videos online. Again, I think people need to see those videos and I'm grateful for those who share them. It just wasn't working for me because to share them, you have to see them and you have to deal with the comments that they then bring about. I stopped having those conversations where I think you've hinted at it, Paul. People are just up for a debate. They don't care. You know, it's just a fun bit of a game to them and it's not to me. It means too much to me. So I'm not even going to go there in those conversations.
Can I jump in for a moment? I acknowledge that I'm interrupting, but you're on something here that I want to make sure that we kind of expand on if we can, because you said it was so interesting because I was thinking it at the moment that you said it. You haven't, through this story, you haven't changed your beliefs. You haven't changed your fundamental stance on animals, compassion to animals, what it means to the choices that you make for your body and your food choices and all of the things, right? And you haven't changed what you believe about what you're seeing in these videos and all of the inhumane treatment and so forth. This, what's interesting here for, I think, a lot of people is often, this is my interpretation. Often we might believe that in order to compromise or in order to kind of bridge the distance, we have to release or relax some of our beliefs. But what I'm hearing you describe is, no, I'm going to continue to hold on to my beliefs because I'm steadfast in them. And I have to find a way to bridge the distance between me and those who hold other beliefs. And there was something that came up and darn it, I've forgotten what it was that I was going to say, but it was like, it almost sounds like when you describe, you know, that you pulled back and you stopped going to the meetings and you stopped sharing the videos. This is what I think I was picking up from you is there's a difference between having a belief system, being steadfast in my beliefs, and creating others in those who don't versus something else that we can share between us, regardless of where we stand on the issue. I'm going to stop. I'm kind of rambling a little bit, but I just wanted to acknowledge that this is not an easy path you've chosen, which is I'm not going to relax my beliefs, but I'm going to relax how I present them. Is that it? Or how I campaign for them? Or I think maybe there's a question in there. Like,
100%.
Say more about what's happening for you at that point.
My vision, my goal is exactly the same. It is just as big. I am no less passionate. My standards and expectations for myself are locked and loaded. I could not be more committed to a happy, healthy, compassionate vegan world. However, my expectations for others, particularly those closest to me, I've lowered them because I think you lower the bar to raise your chance of success, right? Mm-hmm. I had unrealistic expectations and I wasn't meeting people where they were. I was expecting them to meet me where I was, or even I was expecting them to react how I would have reacted, you know, in their position back in the day. However, I know that, you know, from NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, we all have a different map of the world. And that is our values, our beliefs, our life experiences, our goals. They're all different. And I can't expect someone who's had a completely different life to me, I can't expect them to care the same amount about the same thing as I do, and vice versa. You know, there are so many areas where I could be more compassionate, have more learnings, be more open-minded and open-hearted as well. So yeah, my expectations for myself, at least as high as they always were, my expectations for others, I lowered them. So I don't see it as compromise at all because I'm just as passionate. I just see it as, well, I mean, I was about to share the things I started doing. The main thing I started doing was that I started to be more like my mom as a way to honor my mom. So, you know, I say I want to lead with love, compassion, and deliciousness. That is exactly what she did. And yeah, I've lost her. However, the biggest compliment anyone can ever give me is when they say, Katie, you're just like your mom. Now, I didn't used to get that often in my teens and 20s and even 30s. The older I've become, and particularly the last few years, more and more people start to say that. And that is like genuinely the biggest compliment someone can give me.
People can't see you. I can, but people can't see you. And when you talk about your mom, you don't let it out, but I can see how that moves you. I can see it in your eyes. I can see it in your face, how moved you are by talking about your mom and embodying your mom. Mm-hmm. And I just think that's really cool. That says something even more than what you've already shared with us about the relationship that you had with her.
Thank you.
And I want to acknowledge something else too. When you say, I don't know why this feels important for me to say out loud, but when you said to the folks who are listening that you lowered your expectations of others, it feels to me like sometimes there's an easy leap for people to take that the wrong way and feel like that's a criticism. But when we lower our expectations of others, we're not lowering others. We're lowering the standard that we hold them to, right?
Yeah.
we're lowering the criteria by which we judge them. And what you didn't say, but I believe you were saying, correct me if I'm wrong, is that I'm allowing them to be who they are. I mean, yeah. You really kind of did say that, maybe not those exact words, but allowing others to be who they are and pulling back on the everybody needs to be just like me. Boy, that really lands for me because that's something I'm living in right now in this period of years in my life is trying to like do exactly what you've been describing. I'll shut up and let you take it from there.
I love that it lands for you and you're right. It's a good catch. I learned that early days as a personal trainer when I had to let go of my goals for people. I would care more about their goal than they did. And I would get really frustrated if they didn't take all the right eating and exercising actions and get the results I knew they could get. And then I realized eventually that I had some unrealistically high expectation for them, maybe aligned with my expectation for myself. I don't know, but I was making their goal about me, not about them. And I needed to release the pressure and understand what they were actually looking to achieve and what would be success and a win for them, not for me.
Mm. These are such powerful revelations and discoveries. So that actually takes us into the third question, which is, as you look back at this comma that you were sitting on, what did you learn about yourself?
I mean, the obvious thing I learned is, I guess, resilience, and that you can go through the toughest thing that you never dared think about, like mum dying. I would, like, even if she would talk about the will or something, I'd be like, la, 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 don't go there. Like, shut your brain off because that is so painful. You just do not even want to think about it, right? Hmm. And, you know, I was probably in shock for a full year. Life was miserable for 2 full years. Nearly 3 years on, I have joy and happiness in my life again. It is not any easier. I don't think it ever gets easy. However, I learned that level of resilience and that if you can survive this, you can survive anything, and you change and grow and you really can change so much about yourself. Those inbuilt beliefs you have about you. You know, I used to be very dichotomous, very black or white, super stubborn. You know, I've always been incredibly passionate. However, maybe I didn't always use it to the greater good. You know, I probably held myself back with it at times. And I kind of learned all of these things. If you have enough pain or a big enough why filled with emotional intensity, you can change these things about yourself. And so that was a valuable learning.
I appreciate you sharing that. And as you talk about kind of changing your expectations of others and changing how you frame the narrative, changing how you weigh the goals, say more about what you learned. Like, what have you learned? What are you learning about yourself in this new approach to people?
I'm learning that I'm the happiest with myself that I have ever been in my life. You know, I used to really chase and strive and be really, I am super business focused. However, it used to always be about the chasing and the achievement and the probably the significance, if we talk about Tony Robbins' 6 core needs, you know. And it is so much more now for me about the person I am being in the world. And in hindsight, again, that was something that my mom demonstrated to me my entire life. You know, as a teenager, I always looked up to my dad, who was the successful businessman and drove the nice car and wanted to stay in the nice hotels. And it was all about how much money you made and such. And mom was always about, she was successful in her career. She was an amazing nurse. However, it was always about how she made people feel and how she interacted in the world and the warm, generous person she was being. It wasn't so much about the doing, and it certainly wasn't about the having. And so I've gone from a very, this is what I want to have, this is what I want to be known for. I've gone from that to the main thing that I'm striving for is to make me proud. I know I made my mum proud. That's a given. That's locked and loaded. However, the way I want to be in the world every single day is someone that makes me proud. And I'm in a really good space with that.
Nice. That's a big shift. And it's interesting because it almost seems like different ways for the emphasis and the focus to be on self. And maybe this isn't entirely accurate. You tell me, but like earlier, the focus on self was kind of proving that you were right, needing other people to be on board with your beliefs. Although you could argue and say, well, that is the focus on them, right? Trying to convert people. And now the focus is on being okay with how you are, being okay with where you stand and wanting other people to feel good about you and the relationship with them. So it's like almost like this little arc of self.
And wanting me to feel good about me and my relationship with other people. And as much as it's a cliche, also about enjoying the journey, because I can tend to put so much pressure on myself. My goals are huge. You know, I want a vegan world. That's pretty big, right? And it feels really urgent because it is really urgent. However, again, my hard-learned lesson, life is short, right? And we really need to enjoy the journey. We really need to enjoy every single day because there are no guarantees.
And you're very clear about your ultimate kind of vision for the world. So there's a lot to be said for having that kind of clarity too. Kate, the fourth question, I'm sorry, I cut you off. You were about to say something.
Just clarity absolutely resonates with me. That's been my to work on this year. I've started journaling, and every day at the top of the journal, I would write calm and clarity because that's what I was seeking. And I wanted to know how I would achieve this calm and clarity in my life. And funnily enough, a couple of weeks in, I realized that practice of journaling was actually what was helping me achieve the calm and clarity that I then and now do feel. So yeah, clarity is important.
Well, and that kind of then takes us into the fourth question, which is, Kate, what has changed for you as a result of sitting on these commas, this comma?
Yeah, so just this huge clarity of purpose, of the person I want to be in the world, you know, no less driven, just insanely focused on being effective in the way that I am driven. And also on enjoying the journey, you know, not just being that workaholic that I can tend to be. My self-belief has changed. You know, again, that has been a kind of a reoccurring to work on for me over my life. I think I shared right at the beginning of our conversation that I first got into the gym as a means by which to transform both my own body and my confidence. I was a debilitatingly shy teenager. So that self-belief has been a reoccurring theme. And I feel very confident in it now, in the person that I am and the person that I want to continue to be. And, you know, I would say those are the main things that have changed. And there's still, some of them are still to work on every single day. You know, some days are easier than others, right? I'm sure our listeners can all relate to that.
For sure. I am curious, what has changed in your relationship with your father over these past several years?
Nice question. It took a while. So I suggested to my father, we spent 20 odd years in New Zealand. That's where I grew up, even though I'm Australian. And when Mum died, it was actually COVID time and they were in a different state. And this is a whole nother, we don't even need to go here, but basically I had to get compassionate leave to be able to enter her state, to be able to enter ICU to say goodbye. She wasn't conscious, but her body was on life support for organ donation. And I had to tick all these horrific, surreal boxes of COVID time just to be able to say goodbye to her. And it also meant that Australia's borders were closed to New Zealand, and all the dear family friends that had known Mum for decades, our really close family friends, none of them were able to come over. They weren't even able to come over months later when we were finally able to have her life celebration service with other people, her family from around Australia. So I said to my dad, you know, 6 months after Mama died, I said, how about we go back to New Zealand when borders open and we meet, we see all the family friends? And he said, amazing. We did it. We spent 6 nights in New Zealand and we stayed with our dearest family friends. And, you know, one of the many amazing things that happened with all those catch-ups where we were staying with family friends was my father actually saw how all these, my friends my age, his friends his age, 70-year-old men, they would no drama cook a vegan meal for me. Like, we'd be staying and they'd have the fridge stocked and they'd just throw together some little tofu stir fry and it would be no big deal. Mm. And I've got to share, in the entire time that I had been vegan, particularly since I became this really bad influence on my mother and she became plant-based, Dad had not cooked so much as a baked potato for me. Now, I would always make all the sides or full dinners and say, do you want this? And he'd have a fair bit of it and throw his bit of meat on the side. So it had built up in my heart as this kind of block that I do all this cooking for you. You can't even throw a potato in the oven for me. We came back from this New Zealand holiday and the next time I came to visit Dad in Noosa was the 1 year anniversary of Mum dying. I didn't want to be alone. I flew to Noosa. He picked me up. I'd worked a full day in the gym. He drove me home and he said, now, Katie, I know you would have had a really big week to get here, so I made you dinner. And he'd made this full vegan meal for me. And wow. Oh my goodness, my heart. Like, you know, it meant so much. And again, we go backward and forward, but generally, you know, someone, your energy is met. You know, the more love and compassion and zero judgment I put out, it is mirrored back. And so that was a huge step forward in our relationship. And it's not like we share meals all the time, but we're a lot better than we ever have been.
Mm. Well, and it's a testament to almost this degree of kind of releasing, letting go and being patient. And if you have been authentic and led with love, then it will have an impact somewhere down the road. And so there was an influence overall.
Yeah.
And it almost seems like, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but for as passionate and adamant as you were early on about your stance around being vegan, he would seemed to be equally an opposite around being a meat eater. And as you softened, he softened. It is like that had to be a big step for him to be like, okay, well, I'm not going to make this about me. I'm going to make it about her and I can do the thing for her and still hold my beliefs.
100%. And as my dear mum used to say, because we would debrief on all the annoying non-vegans in our life every single week when we spoke, and often Dad would be the primary topic of conversation. But she did used to say to me, one of her best quotes was, Katie, it's like you're banging your head up against a brick wall and the noise is annoying your father. And I'm like, it's painful for me and it's just annoying him.
Wow. That one, that's a quote right there. I love it.
Yeah.
Kate, last question of the five. What does getting off the comma look like for you?
It looks like an immense amount of self-belief and self-certainty. It looks like freedom from all the energy I used to waste on stuff that wasn't getting me or the animals, or the planet, or the people I love anywhere. And it looks like gratitude for so much in my life, for my mom, for the relationship I now have with my father, just for those everyday small things.
Mm, I love it. Kate, thank you for sharing the story with us and for opening up. There's certainly a lot of very vulnerable moments in what you've been describing for us. And I know your journey continues as well. I've certainly taken some things from this. As you look back at the conversation we've had and the telling of your story, what would you acknowledge yourself for in sharing this with us?
I think I've been pretty genuine and open-hearted, and that was my goal. So I'm happy with that.
Nice. Kate, How can people find you? Obviously, we're going to put all your links and descriptions in the show notes. So walk us through if somebody wanted to look you up, see what you were up to, maybe even reach out to you, contact you. Where can people find you?
The best place is the main website, strongbodygreenplanet.com. Via that, you find my healthification podcast, 880 plus episodes deep. So I talk to passionate and compassionate athletes, activists, doctors, entrepreneurs, authors. The podcast is my absolute heart. 10 years on, it better be.
Wow.
Several guest appearances from my dear mum on that show, which I am so grateful for now in hindsight. You'll also find the Plant Positive Journal. So this is a journal, daily planner, basically a step-by-step to adopt a healthy plant-based lifestyle, full of recipes, full of artwork. It is a venture of the heart, and it is absolutely dedicated to my dear mum. So that is... you know, that's probably my number one focus now. Version 2 has just come out, and it was designed to lead with love, compassion, and deliciousness, which is my mission.
Okay, nice. And then the last thing that we do before we wrap things up is we do this in every episode. Since this podcast is all about sharing stories and personal experiences and lifting up voices, we can't finish without giving you an opportunity to lift up voices of people who are close to you. And we call this acknowledgments. And so as you think about your circle, who would you boost, give a voice to, or lift up? And that can be causes, organizations, other creators, people in your family. So thinking about that, we'll put all their information in the show notes. Who would you like to acknowledge today?
The person I think I go to when I think, who do I want to spend time with right now, the person whose energy I most love, is Dr. Will Tuttle. He wrote The World Peace Diet, and it's an amazing transformative book, a big, beautiful beast of a book that talks about our food system and our relationship with the planet. And he has that. I've interviewed him several times. He has that open-heartedness that I said is so rare, and it is so genuine in him. So that's Dr. Will Tuttle. I'd also love to shout out Chef Babette Davis, who is a woman in her 70s, and to look at her, you would think she was in her 40s. She advocates for a whole food plant-based lifestyle, and she is just such a powerhouse. And I think my conversation with her was one of the first times where I really started to get absolute clarity on how much more impactful it is to lead with love rather than hate. She just emanates love and a powerful force for good. The third and final one I want to shout out to is actually photojournalist for the animals, Joanne McCarper, and We Animals Media. So that is just a powerful resource, and it is just a wealth of heartbreaking, and I also hope heart-opening photojournalism, and they just really do an amazing amount of good.
Thank you for sharing all of these. Definitely, as with every episode, I encourage folks listening to go to the show notes, check out not only Kate's contact information, but also these folks and organizations and sites that she is acknowledging today, so that you can learn a little bit more and find ways to get involved if this speaks to you. So Kate, thank you so much for being up very early in the morning, your time over there in Australia, and sharing this with us, and welcome to our community of storytellers. Look forward to hearing more from you as your journey evolves.
Paul, thank you so much for the opportunity, and thank you for creating this safe, open space to have such a heartfelt conversation without judgment. I really, really respect and appreciate it.
Thank you. It's a calling and it's a privilege, I have to say. So have a wonderful week ahead.
You too.
What an honor it is for me to witness these powerful stories. I hope you feel the same way too. Think about what you learned from this conversation. What stood out for you? What challenged you? What inspired you? And I encourage you to write it down in some form of journaling and reflection. Surprises can reveal themselves to you when you do this. And if you were moved by today's conversation, pass it along to someone you care about. Let's spread the word. Let's continue to build connection. And if you do discover something you'd like to unpack further, book a call with me and let's talk about it. My links are in the show notes. Be sure to like this episode, follow the podcast here on this platform and social media at Off the Comma, and feel free to comment and interact with these posts and episodes. Check out my website for workshops, events, and my sponsor community. I'm covering the costs of production by curating my own sponsors who align with our vision. Be sure to check them out. They're all powerful people and businesses. Thank you for listening to this episode of Off the Comma. As always, keep noticing and keep listening.